this world of ours, there are some things which simply never happen. That's how you can tell that this film is running backwards. In the 19th century, physicists realized that the universe was governed by a fundamental, underlying principle. Crudely speaking, it was this. But left to themselves, things tend to fall apart and reach a state of uniform chaos. It means that structures like these can only fall down. They can't reconstitute themselves from their own rubble. If we look around here, it's easy to get the impression that those gloomy predictions of the 19th century physicists are a panicky exaggeration. Here in these tranquil, ornamental gardens, there are no obvious indications that the world is grinding to a standstill or that the heat death of the universe is likely to occur in the foreseeable future. And yet, if we inspect things a little more closely, we can see signs of that irreversible process. These walls and statues, which were made for Pope Julius III in the 16th century, are no longer in the state that they were when they were first inspected by their proud occupant. In fact, you could say that these statues, in one sense, have outlived their original owner. But one of the reasons why they've lasted so long is because they've retained the original substance, the original marble, which was used by the sculptor to make them in the first place. But that's also the very reason why they began to fall apart invisibly at the moment when they were first completed. History doesn't record how this nymph lost her nose, but once it had been brushed off, that was it. Whereas this object here can retain its shape in spite of such accidents. And the reason why it can do so is because it's an example of what scientists call an open system. That's to say, it retains its shape because the substance which makes up that shape is flowing through it rather than staying in it. Of course, it's changing its shape slightly from moment to moment. But all the same, it retains an average outline, enough to allow us to distinguish the shape of this fountain from that one over there. A statue preserves its shape as far as it can, whereas a fountain actually performs it. In order to accomplish this improbable feat of remaining aloft in a universe where water tends to find its own level, the fountain has to be provided with a special source of energy. Here in the Villa Giulia, the energy is provided by the very tendency of water to find its own level,
by falling from a reservoir all the way up there, and by coming through pipes which converge onto a nozzle, the system has just enough energy to rear up an endless overflow of substance, which makes up the immortal shape of the fountain. Now, of course, it doesn't have to be gravity. A modern fountain is worked by a small pump, which is powered either by petrol or by electricity. But there has to be a source of energy of some sort. Each fountain owes its life and its wobbling improbability to the unceasing theft of energy. And in that sense, it resembles those things which are growing alongside it. The shape and structure of these plants is just as much of a performance as that of the fountain which feeds them. But the pump, or the energy which keeps this spray performing, is distributed throughout its very substance. In fact, paradoxically, the shape, the structure, the appearance of this plant is the very apparatus with which it filches the energy which it needs to maintain its shape. That modest little fountain there is a parasite on the head of pressure, whereas this plant is a parasite on the sun. That's why it's green. That's why it has leaves. In fact, this whole flimsy apparatus is simply an elaborate machine for robbing the sun of the energy which it needs to outwit the universal running down of things. And so, for that reason, although this statue looks more like me than a fountain does, the fountain actually is more like me. Because, like a fountain, I too am an open system through which material continuously flows, briefly expressing itself as me before it vanishes once again into the world at large, from which, like the fountain, I withdraw some of it again in order to maintain myself. Here's another open system which relies on the expenditure of energy. In the 19th century, the energy that was needed to bring water to the growing towns of Victorian Britain was provided by enormous steam engines. Engines like this weren't used to drive ornamental fountains, but the principle was just the same. Work, mechanical work, had to be done in order to maintain the right head of pressure. And in order to do that mechanical work, energy had to be released from combustible materials and then converted into mechanical action. The discovery that mechanical work could be obtained from heat through the medium of steam helped man to recognize the way in which his own energy was obtained from food. From fuel, in other words. The propulsive power of steam had, of course, been recognized and even to some extent exploited in antiquity. But until James Watt had perfected the 17th century steam engine by the addition of things like the separate condenser, steam power remained comparatively feeble, just enough to work those Alexandrian conjuring tricks like the one we saw in the program on the heart. But the amount of useful work which could be obtained from machines like this was comparatively negligible, so that no one considered the fundamental principles that were involved. There was no reason to think that there was a formal, quantitative relationship between the fuel, the temperature, the steam pressure, and the mechanical work. But once these machines improved to the point where substantial amounts of money could be made from them, then of course there was an obvious incentive to consider the mathematical principles, so that more money could be made, and of course even less spent. So by being forced to consider the economics of the new invention, the invention itself was soon visualized as an economic model. But what makes this engine different from a living organism is that it has no way of repairing itself. And what's even more important, it can't go in search of the fuel that keeps it running. The smallest unit which is capable of doing both these things is the living cell. These are single-celled animals. They're called paramecium. The remarkable thing about them is that although they are living in the environment to which they are best fitted, their very existence is at risk from that environment. The only way they could be safe, indeed the only way in which any organism could be entirely safe, would be to live in a monotonous and unvarying environment, Even so, the very fact that they are distinguishable from the water in which they live means that they have to spend their whole life preventing themselves from vanishing into it. The water in which they live is constantly seeping into their interior. It's not possible to see that on this film, but if we increase the magnification, we can see small circular areas in the cell. These are little pumps or vacuoles which fill up with the seepage, contract, and then squeeze the water out. This bailing out must be done constantly in order to remain alive. And like the Victorian pumping engines, this work needs a constant supply of fuel. And that means an endless supply of food. Finding your food and digesting it is also an energy-consuming business. And as with so many things, it can become much more efficient if it's a group enterprise. Here, thousands of cells are working together, and we call the company a hydra. It's even possible to see some of the individual members of the company. Those little granules in the tentacles are individual cells. And here comes the fuel. It's a perfect example of the division of labor. Poisonous cysts in the tentacles paralyze the prey, and now it'll be digested for the common good, so that the fuel or energy received can be shared between the cells and the hydra can survive to repeat the process. Primitive organisms as small as these are exposed to the whims of an unpredictable universe, and if the surroundings begin to vary too much, even the most energetic powers of compensation are overwhelmed. One of the ways in which the cells can defend themselves against such dangerous variations in the world around them is to congregate into large communities big enough to include an internal environment, and then to develop and share mechanisms which can stabilize that environment to the advantage of all the constituent members. So when a creature is as large and as complicated as this stickleback, it's not simply in an environment, it actually is an environment. The stickleback cells don't live in the water, they live in this organism, which when clumped together and organized, we call a stickleback. And when they're clumped together like this, it's called a dolphin. And since this is a warm-blooded mammal, the cell's internal environment is even more isolated, even more stable and secure. Passengers and staff in a modern airliner are rather like the cells of a large mammal, existing in the comfort and security of an internal environment, one which stays more or less the same regardless of extreme changes in the outside world. Excuse me, I wonder if I could have some more ice, please. Thank you. You see what I mean? I mean, there's something absolutely absurd about asking for extra ice when one's flying 9 miles above the North Atlantic. I mean, here I am drinking a whiskey and soda, worrying about running out of reading matter before I reach the end of the journey. I mean, outside there, I wouldn't last for a moment. 55,000 feet, flying at Mach 2. It's jolly easy to take this reassuring monotony for granted. What's that fool doing out there?
Very comfortable. It's windy and it's cold and I can't even speak properly up here. Now, although it's not the first thought that leaps to mind, this might be what life as a cell in one of those very uncomplicated organisms is like. Well, something like.
To some extent, the comfortable monotony of a large modern airliner is a question of its sheer size. When something's as large as this, it can easily enclose a secure internal environment. But size also offers another advantage as well. When a machine's as big as this, the internal volume is relatively much greater than the area of its outside surface, so the passenger is automatically insulated. But when something's as small as that, the passenger bears the immediate brunt of the atmosphere, and like a single cell, he would be wiped out if the weather or the altitude changed too much. But it's not simply a question of size alone. The mechanisms on this aircraft actively maintain the passenger's environment. The cabin is sensitively pressurized. The oxygen is kept at just the right level, and the temperature is maintained. Outside there, I'd freeze to death in a moment, and my blood would simply evaporate. Well, most, if not all, the mechanisms of a complex animal serve the same purpose that they do on this aircraft. They're designed to stabilize and maintain an internal environment. And the more of such mechanisms that an animal has, then of course the freer it is to move at ease and survive any environmental changes which it meets. Well, this principle was first recognized in the middle of the 19th century by the great French physiologist Claude Bernard. He saw that the most successful species, that is to say the most ambitious ones, were those which could keep their cells in a monotonous internal environment, regardless of where they went. In fact, for him, the constancy of this internal environment was the absolute prerequisite for a free life. And this, of course, depended on the existence of certain mechanisms which could first of all recognize and then counteract environmental change. Well, this principle transformed modern medicine. In fact, you could say that the success of modern medicine is due to our ability to reproduce and imitate each and every one of these regulating mechanisms as and when they fail. But that, of course, depends on our knowing exactly how they work.
Men have always tried to design machines which worked at a consistent rate. But until the 18th century, this involved the work of a human supervisor, someone who could recognize when the machine was running too fast or too slowly. He would then step in and adjust the speed to fit the task he wanted the machine to perform. With the invention of the centrifugal governor, though, the millwrights of East Anglia hit on a device which did this automatically. It was an apparatus which allowed the machine to monitor its own behavior without having to be constantly cared for by a watchful invigilator. With this little machine, the engine robs or taxes some of its own output and feeds back a regulating influence on that output. The spinning governor alters the distance between the rotating grindstones, which is either narrowed to increase the friction and slow the mill down, or widened to speed it up. By making constant small adjustments, the governor ensures that the flour is ground at a steady consistency. The engineer, James Watt, recognized that this could be applied to the automatic regulation of the newly invented steam engine. He soon incorporated the governor, which rapidly became an essential part of the steam technology of the 19th century. The faster the engine goes, the further out the weights swing, and the more a sliding sleeve is pulled down. This pulls a lever, which cuts down the input of steam entering the cylinder from the boiler. The power diminishes, the engine begins to slow down once again, and the revolving balls fall back into place. By hunting between these two extremes, the governor automatically stabilizes the speed of the machine so that it rotates at the speed which the engineer has decided as the most efficient for the work which is being done. As they perfected this device, trying, for example, to eliminate undue wobbles, the engineers and mathematicians of the 19th century began to appreciate the abstract logical principles which the steam governor exemplified. So, engines like this have provided not merely one, but two metaphors which have been usefully applied to the living body. First, they need to consume energy in order to work. But second, they have regulating mechanisms on board which ensure that the whole system runs at an even rate. In the words of one Harvard physiologist at the beginning of this century, science has learned more from the steam engine than the steam engine has learned from science. In the 1870s, the English scientist James Clerk Maxwell wrote an influential mathematical treatise which laid out the fundamental logic of what we now call negative feedback. Once this was appreciated as an abstract principle in its own right, it could be applied to any mechanism whose efficiency depended on the maintenance of a steady state. Well, the same principle applies to everything that's happening on board this aircraft. Now, for example, I notice a slight departure from my normal comfortable state. I feel slightly thirsty. So what do? Well, a system of communication which transmits a message.
Can I get you anything to drink, sir?
Oh, yes, please. Could I have a club soda, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Then, you see, just the right action to cancel out the discrepancy. you see, it doesn't only apply to the comfort, it also applies to the running and the efficiency and the safety of the aircraft. Look, let's go up the sharp end and have a look.
Very easy to get the impression that these chaps are flying the aircraft. Well, they're not really. The aeroplane is actually flying itself. And what they are is skilled invigilators who are watching all the instruments, and they're ready to take over if any of the automatic systems fail. But normally, the whole thing simply takes care of itself. Look, suppose a gust of turbulence lifts one of the wings. Well, now, left to itself, the plane would gradually go off course and it might land up in, say, Oslo rather than London. But as it is, there's a special instrument which recognizes how much we've rolled and then sends quite a small electrical impulse right back there into the fuselage to a powerful slave motor which moves the control surfaces and brings the plane back online again. So the aircraft is stable. But of course, it's a different sort of stability to the one it has when it's standing firmly on the ground. It's an active stability. And in fact, there are literally hundreds of mechanisms which ensure that the plane flies uneventfully and successfully from A to B. And in that sense, it's rather like the human body. But in order to understand how the aircraft does this, and how the human body does for that matter, we really have to appreciate what stability means and recognize how many forms of stability there are. Let me try and explain what I mean by stability and instability. Well, here's an example of a stable object. Its base is broad in relationship to its height. That means that it'll tilt a long way before it falls over. Now, this object is also stable, but rather less so. A pencil on end will stay upright as long as it's not pushed beyond the point where its center of gravity falls outside the area of its base. But since it's long and thin, much taller than its base, a small tilt is enough to push it off balance. However, it's easy to overcome this instability by sticking the pencil into a weighted ball. So, now, when you push the pencil, the weight of the base, the ball, is enough to swing it back into position again. However, the work of restoration uses up some of the energy which I used in order to displace it in the first place. Both these forms of stability are purely passive. They take no action.
But here's an object with about the same proportions as a pencil. But we can see that it maintains its stability in a completely different way. If it's pushed, it briefly puts out a leg and broadens its own base, instantly acquiring the proportions of the Eiffel Tower. Well, almost. Unlike the pencil with the weighted base, this is an active response which involves the recognition of the threat and the release of stored energy. Now, here's another one. The cat has a neurological spirit level which tells the brain when the cat's off balance.
This automatically releases the energetic actions which are needed to bring the whole cat back online again. There are limits to this, and if the cat injures itself on landing, unlike Concorde, it has the ability to repair the damage. Well, this process of automatic repair starts with something called inflammation. And the first person to recognize this fact was the Scottish surgeon John Hunter.
But if inflammation develops, regardless of the cause, still it is an effect whose purpose it is to restore the parts to their natural function.
I can show this by inflicting a mild injury on myself. If I draw a firm line down the skin of my own forearm, a familiar red streak appears. Apparently, more blood is flowing into the injured area. That's what accounts for the heat. Hot blood is now flowing into the cool skin from the center of my body.
Now, if we wait a few moments more, you'll see a distinct ridge appear along the red streak, a weal, a small local swelling. Yes, beginning to come up now. Now, these responses are more useful than they seem, but we'll see why in a moment. Let's consider first of all what causes them. Well, the injured cells actually release a substance which alters the vessels in that area and allows extra blood to flow in. So the process has two stages. First of all, the vessels are prepared by the release of the substance, and then the blood flows in. Now, you can prove quite easily that the two stages are independent by a very simple experiment. I can cause the substance to be released by injuring my arm, but prevent it from showing up by stopping the blood from flowing into the arm. So if I, first of all, drain my arm of blood by holding it upwards for a few moments, and then apply a tourniquet in order to prevent any more blood from reaching it, I have to blow the tourniquet up above my own arterial blood pressure in order to prevent the heart from blowing blood into the arm. At this point, you will find that it's no longer possible to obtain the raised red weal. We'll see, though, that it appears again as soon as I allow the blood back into the vessels by releasing the tourniquet. So, you've isolated the arm now. There's no blood flowing into it. And I'll put a scratch alongside the one which I did just before. So, now, it was applied with the same pressure as the previous scratch, so presumably it's injured the cells in that region by the same amount. But whereas this one came up almost immediately, we could wait here until I was blue in the face, if not red in the arm. And no raised red weal will appear until I let the blood back into the arm by releasing the cuff. Ooh, slightly uncomfortable as it comes back. And you'll notice that the arm is also flushed pink all over, which is due to being deprived of oxygen while the cuff was on. So I'm just going to let the blood run out of the skin a little bit so that you can see the streak against a whiter background. When I put it back again, you'll see that the red streak now appears quite clearly, just as bright as the one I put on the other side of the arm. It's coming up quite nicely. And if we wait a little bit longer, the ridge will appear as well. Here it comes. So, although the inflammatory substance has actually been released by the injury that I inflicted on the skin, it can't actually show its effects until the blood is allowed to flow back into the injured part and into the vessels which have been prepared by the substance. It's almost like drawing a streak of light on a photographic plate, but not being able to see it until it's been flooded with a developer. Ah, there it is. It's quite nice. Now, most of this inflammatory substance is in fact the substance called histamine. Histamine is stored in certain specialized cells which can be found in every tissue of the body. When it's released by injury, and it doesn't matter what the cause of the injury is, it can be mechanical or thermal, bacterial or chemical, it always produces the same response: heat, redness and swelling.
But what value do these responses have? At first sight, heat and swelling seem like an unnecessary nuisance.
Well, let's go right under the skin and see what's happening. Sloping across the screen, there's a small artery close to the injured area. Now, already we can see a tributary opening up and flooding with red cells. This surge of blood is what accounts for the redness and warmth on the surface. The walls of the small vessel have also become rather leaky, so that clear plasma starts to ooze out of the bloodstream and into the surrounding tissue, and that's what causes the swelling back on the surface. All this prepares the building site, and here come the construction workers. It's just possible to make out white cells beginning to stick to the walls of the vessel. Soon, they'll begin to worm their way through the vessel and into the injured area. Now here's one white cell surrounded by bacteria which have probably got in through small punctures in the skin where I scratched my arm. Drawn to the site by the lure of chemical substances released from the injured tissue, the task of the white cells is to ingest and destroy not only these intruders, but also the debris caused by the injury. Oddly enough, we seem to have come full circle. Here, inside a human environment, are single cells behaving exactly like their primitive colleagues in the outside world. When these cells have completed their task, the process of healing and repair can start, restoring my arm to something like its former state. But this is not the only way in which we restore the biological status quo. Changes of temperature in the outside world can also be a threat to survival. As soon as I take a hot bath, I feel hot. My skin flushes as the blood is diverted to the surface, where it's normally able to cool down. But because the water in which I'm immersed is hotter than my blood, I can't cool until I step out of the bath. In this electronically coded picture, my hot skin is seen as white. As it begins to cool down, though, various colors will start to replace the white. Specially trained technicians would be able to tell what temperature these colors were. For our purposes, though, white is hot and black is cold. And the spectrum of colors represents the range of temperature in between. As you can see, my arm, or at least the surface, is beginning to turn purple. Now here's another object in contact with hot water. It doesn't have any way of stabilizing its temperature, and even a tea cozy can only slow down the cooling process. If the cozy is removed, the cooling accelerates, and eventually the once hot white teapot will return to cool black and will thermally vanish into its own environment. Not vanished, though. The coloured patches show that my skin may have cooled, but unlike the teapot,
I'm constantly replenishing my own heat by burning the fuel that I've eaten. And what's even more important, since I'm a mammal, I'm equipped with mechanisms which can limit the cooling and keep it down to a minimum. The goose pimples on my skin are a futile attempt to trap warm air by bristling the surface hairs where my pelt would have been in my primitive mammalian ancestors. Animals bristle their fur to trap a layer of warm air. Overheating poses just as much of a threat. Skin flushes with warm blood, and the evaporating sweat helps to carry the surplus heat away. As with most things, it's only when these self-regulating mechanisms are knocked out or paralyzed by injury and illness that we can appreciate how complex and indispensable they are. It's in intensive care units that the knowledge of these mechanisms and how they work has made one of its biggest contributions to modern medicine. This man's nervous system no longer recognizes the need for oxygen, so that he has to be automatically ventilated or breathed by a machine. He can no longer cough and protect his own lungs, so a nurse must suck all the fluids from his air passage. Any fluid which has slipped past is helped drain by a vigorous slapping on the chest. Even the automatic beat of his heart is in jeopardy. So any slowing has to be automatically recognized, and a pacemaker steps in to beat for it. In health, all this would be done by an internal feedback loop to the brain. Information about the state of the patient's body is collected and displayed to the outside world. This informs the nursing staff of what's going on, and they become part of the automatic governor, just like the stewardesses in the aeroplane. This patient's blink reflex is gone and needs to be replaced. He can no longer swallow, so his mouth has to be periodically cleaned out. All this and more is necessary to maintain the life of someone who has lost the systems that regulate his internal environment. Here is someone who has not yet acquired these mechanisms. This baby should still be inside its mother's body. The intensive care provided by its mother's womb gives the child time to assemble the machinery necessary to survive on its own in the outside world. But like a passenger thrown out of a jet aircraft, it's been disembarked 10 weeks early. And now it has to face the stress of a dangerous universe without this armory of protective functions. Such a negligible mass of living matter is much more susceptible to changes in the environment. Simply by being as small as it is, it tends to lose or gain heat much faster than a full-size baby would. So it's kept warm, and its temperature is carefully monitored. This also applies to all the other systems which would be automatic and self-regulating in a baby which was born at the right time. These two patients, one near the end of his life and one at the very start, undocked from their own service modules, are being treated like stranded astronauts, marooned on a world in which they can't survive without ground support.
For the unconscious or the immature, life on this earth is just as hazardous as it is on the planets to which healthy men have made their journeys of exploration. As long as these men are enclosed in the sealed volume of their space capsule, their own self-regulating equipment is almost enough to guarantee their survival. The one thing they are lacking, though, is the steady stimulus of gravity. So they have to undertake farcically strenuous exercises to keep in trim for the return to earthly heaviness. Even so, they're still at risk, and like premature babies lost in space, their vital functions have to be monitored by a nursing staff on Earth. Once they step out of the relative security of their metal womb, it's like being born into a world for which they were never meant. Their ability to cruise freely around this unfriendly environment is due to the fact that the engineers on Earth have provided them with suits which include a replica of the environment they have left 250,000 miles away. Perhaps you remember that in the first part of the program, I said that the ideal situation would be to find an environment where monotony actually removed the need for action. But since there are no places like this, the body creates it for the cells of which it's made. In the absence of an external environment which shows no change, the body must ceaselessly stir itself in order to create one inside. As the French physiologist Claude Bernard said in the middle of the 19th century, the absolute condition for a free life is the constancy of the internal environment. By restlessness, we achieve tranquility.